Hello and welcome. I'm going to give people a few more minutes to join in. And then we'll get started with a conversation. A reminder for those of you who need closed captioning, it is available. Subtitles are enabled. A reminder that it is live subtitling, so it is not perfect, especially when we start talking about things like queer things. All right, well, let's go ahead and get started. My name is Dr. Wes Eli King. That is my now name. I teach at the University of Washington in the School of Information, and I teach undergraduate courses on informatics. I recently completed my PhD at the University of Washington, and my research for my dissertation was on LGBTQ plus Christians and their use of dating apps. And I am a supporter of the Believer app. If you haven't heard of it, check it out. I have my water bottle with all the Believer stickers. They are a sponsor of the conference. And I'm excited to be here today to talk with you a little bit about Jesus and gender. And I entitle this talk, Community Over Conformity. And it's really going to be interactive in a lot of ways. And I've noticed that I don't have the capacity to do breakout rooms. And I guess I should check in with the operations person here if that's an option for us at all. But if not, we will just have a lively discussion here in the room, I hope. And this would be, it's way more fun when it's interactive. So that's all I have to say about that. And hopefully we can get some good ideas sharing between all of us. One of my approaches to teaching and learning is constructionist in the sense that together we construct knowledge. So as I've heard, your mics and cameras are disabled because this is being conducted in a webinar format. And so you will have to participate in the chat. So that's not a problem at all. And you'll just have to be good at typing in your answers. And I've been doing this for a while, teaching in Zoom University. I teach about 340 students a quarter, undergraduates, and it's quite fun doing that on Zoom. So I must confess, and I'm saying this to all of you who are in the room, because you are the people that I was really looking forward to experiencing community with this weekend. And I know many of us are grieving that we are not able to meet in person yet again. And so I just want to share my own condolences if any of you are experiencing that grief, as well as let you know that I am with you in that. And so hopefully together we can hold space for that grief that we're experiencing, while also embracing the opportunity that we have to be with each other, even in this format. And I'm stopping sharing for just a minute here because I really don't want you to be just looking at a slide while I'm thinking so personally about this. Community is very important to me. And when we think about God making a way where there is no other way, community and conformity are key ideas in that. And many of us have had our way to being ourselves in the world blocked because of ideas of conformity that are policed and enforced and legitimated through the authorizing of these ideas using biblical texts. And I do not believe that is the purpose of our historical, scriptural, spiritual influence of the biblical texts. And community is a core concept that I see in the larger story and the larger tradition of Christianity. And so my hope was to be with you in person and to facilitate interactions between you all as well as with you all and myself. But here we are in the Zoom community, and I am thrilled and honored to be here with you. And I'm glad to hear that that some of you are moving into acceptance. I feel like I've gotten there today as well. And I'm very, very grateful to be here with you and to be thinking about making a way for understanding gender in light of our understanding of Jesus. So I'm going to go back to sharing my screen here and make sure it's enabled for everything. And here we go. So one of the reasons that I like to talk about Jesus and gender is I believe that understanding how Jesus may have interacted with gender roles might help us to better imagine how we can interact with prevailing cultural constructs of gender in our time. I first wrote a paper on this topic of Jesus and gender in the Gospel of John, and I first presented this work at the Society of Vineyard Scholars. At the time it was not affirming and welcoming, and it still is wrestling with that particular notion in the Vineyard denomination. However, it was a well-received conversation, and I think it's important regardless of where we are in our understanding of Christianity and of Jesus and of the Bible. That we continue to have these conversations, not just me preaching to the choir, but also I choose to continue to stay engaged in conversations with those who may not be as accepting and as affirming as I am. So I am excited to talk about how we understand gender today, as well as how Jesus might have understood it in the past. So first of all, you know, I think we need to start off from ground zero. And I set this up for breakouts, but since we don't have breakouts, I'm going to invite you to discuss this in the chat. So, you know, think about if you're attending this conference in the room with another person, which I know some people are, it's wonderful. I see some names on the chat there that are, you know, two people. Go ahead and take a minute to maybe talk with each other and then type in your ideas of how you think about, like, what is gender? And I'll give you a couple of minutes to do that. And see about setting up a timer here. I'm really good at setting up timers for my students. Even though y'all are not my students, it's still helpful. That's all I gotta say. Ooh, I can even like, won't be as good as broadcasting Spotify. I couldn't get Spotify to work on presenting and all of that. I've had trouble with it lately, but I can play it on my phone. So if any of you teach at all, one of the things that I found is helpful and interesting is I tried to use music as a timer instead of actually setting a timer. And if I could find the song I was looking for, we'll be even better off. We're not going to take the full 7 minutes, so we'll just give you a few minutes to type in your ideas there. So I see Kathy and Bobby asked a wonderful question, which we'll get into a little bit more of, whether I'm asking about gender identity, gender roles, gender expectations, or physical gender. And isn't that part of the problem? Do we even know what we are talking about? As Shari says, gender is confusing and messy. I understand it is a societal cultural construct, and a number of you have brought up this idea of a social construct or a societal construct, our cultural construct. And I think this is very relevant and important for us to think about the ways that our understanding of our bodies and how to be a human with a particular kind of body in society, in culture, is constructed, right? As I said, like, I like to construct this knowledge together here in this room. That's what goes on in societies and in culture in general, right? We agree upon things. We construct our understanding of things together. So we have Mother MJ, and I was like, oh, hell no. That's great, MJ, thank you. And let's see, what are we going to call our ordained reverends, etc. I love what you all have been sharing in the chat here. And so I'll highlight a few that I think are interesting. And I don't want you to think that just because I didn't mention your chat that I don't think it's interesting, but there's a lot of good stuff in here. So take the time to read through it if you've already posted. Thinking about gender as a form of control, it's interesting to have that idea because I was just participating in a Center for Applied Trans Studies symposium earlier today and talking about those power dynamics and how it is so important to keep power in mind when we're thinking about concepts like gender and sex and how power is always circulating and flowing. And it's not necessarily something, you know, one person possesses power and holds it over another. However, power is given, power is taken, power is used, and power is a part of our way of knowing in the world today. And so I think it's very important to keep those things in mind. And then, you know, some people talked about social roles, and I think this is very important. So it's not just about a social construct, but oftentimes a lot of the kind of early research on gender that was, you know, very much limited to like male and female was looking at roles. And then there was this connection between roles and our brains and roles and our bodies and other things like that. So gender identity, gender expression, gender or sex assigned at birth, all of these things make up big parts of how we as a society today think about gender. A number of you talked about like the confusion, things like that, and you know, maybe bringing in some other metaphors that are not so binary. Van identifies as gender fluid, and I identify as gender queer and gender fluid, and I am getting a tattoo worked on later today, so it's just started here. And it's going to be the gender queer flag. So it'll have a purple band and a white band and a green band. I tend to like those better than the gender fluid flag. I don't remember what those colors are, but I decided to make my gender queer flag fluid. So it's got drips and drops. So there's my gender fluid, gender queer that's going to be right there on my wrist. And so gender is a concept that I think we're very maybe confused about. I remember back in the day, so it wasn't too long ago, but some of you may have heard of Mark Driscoll and Mars Hill Church and the extremely conservative and rigid gender roles and gender expectations and, you know, the mixed martial arts Jesus images that were just, you know, difficult to even see. And I know many people who were harmed by that particular system. And one of the arguments, you know, in that day was you know, and this was, you know, Mark Driscoll's and others, you know, and more of the conservative, is we're having a crisis of masculinity, a crisis of fatherhood, a crisis of manhood. So we need to make sure that we get this, you know, really clear and really solidified. And so there has been, as we have been expanding our understanding of gender and gender roles and gender identities and gender expressions and like, and really expanding those, for some people that, it, you know, brings fear and they don't know what to do. And so they want to fix it or they want to make it go away. And so, so this confusion about gender still exists in many people's minds. And so we're going to talk a little bit more about it, and hopefully y'all won't leave confused, but you know, I'm not going to make any promises right now. I'm just gonna give you what I've got, and then we'll go from there. So, gender ideas then and now. I'm sure most of you are familiar with the idea that the concept of gender itself is relatively new, as well as our understanding of what it means to be a man or a woman in society has changed over time, as well as it varies across cultures. So this variability in our ideas about gender is just part of the world we live in, and it's beautiful, and it's the diversity of God's creation is amazing to me. And so when we have these homogenizing ideas that are out there, I get very sad because I love the diversity of the beauty of humanity. And so how did we get to this homogenizing place? We can think about that together. But I'd like to go through some of the, you know, maybe then and now kind of ideas that that we interact with as those who are connected by the Christian tradition or by our faith in Jesus, any of those things that have brought you to the Q Christian Fellowship. This idea that gender is created by God, and the historical and beautiful biblical texts of the origin stories that have been written in conversation with these narratives at the time of creation have been interpreted in ways that have privileged maleness and masculinity and have positioned the creation of us, that the text says they are created in the image of God and of us. And it's this multiplicity that we see in the creation narrative that is often missed and misinterpreted, as well as this understanding of how the dominance of maleness and masculinity in the surrounding cultures of the time was harmful, and the idea that women were created from the same stuff as a man was in direct opposition to other creation narratives at the time. And so there are many different ways to interpret this narrative of the creation story that is way more inclusive of a diversity and a multiplicity of gender expressions, gender roles, gender identities, all of those things that we might think of when we think about gender. And so when we look to the past to address, you know, and to determine, right? That's a very deterministic view of gender, that gender is determined by some foundational property. Like, for example, created by God. So your gender is determined by this, however God created you. And we have been, you know, raised in this tradition that has emphasized in many ways that gender and sex are intended for reproduction. And, you know, we can look at many of the biblical texts that like people use to kind of assert this idea of being intended for reproduction. And I like to go to Monty Python personally, you know, every sperm is sacred. And, you know, and these ideas of, you know, this is the only reason that there are, you know, potentially these differences in human anatomy, right? Our biological sex, right? So we have this intention, right? So God intended this feature of humans to be like this now and forever. And I don't necessarily read that and understand that from the biblical text. And I'm not going to go into like a full-blown, you know, like biblical exegesis of anything today. We'll touch on a little bit of scripture later. But my understanding of this idea is, you know, okay, sure, there is a reproductive functions that exist in relationship to our body parts. However, this mandate that many people hearken to, right? They hearken to this idea of, you know, God said, man and woman, and, you know, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And when they go to that argument about gender, like this is why we have to have men who are men and women who are women, because we need to, you know, fulfill God's command. I ask them, so how do we know when the earth is full? Who decides when the earth is full? What will we do with our bodies when the earth is full? Will these aspects of us that are wonderful and pleasurable and designed to do more than reproduce, but to create amazing and wonderful feelings and give us healthy hormones and all of those kinds of things, is that just going to go away when the earth is full? And I wonder about that. Like, how might humans change because of climate change, because of famine, and many other things, right? We don't know when the earth is going to be full. And, you know, who knows, by then we'll have colonized Mars and, you know, it won't matter. We can still go on and reproduce somewhere else. And, you know, maybe all of the people who are stuck on, you know, a certain way of thinking about gender will all migrate to their own planet. I'm not saying that's what we should do, but, you know, we have lots of room for expansion in our understanding of gender. So, you know, back then, you know, in the biblical times, they didn't have this notion of biological sex, right? So, you know, we had these narratives, we had these, you know, creation stories, the Enuma Elish, you know, the biblical text. There are many other, you know, native cultures and many other cultures in the world, the, you know, the Chinese culture, and we have African cultures who have creation stories that, you know, are very interesting. And they may even talk about, you know, these ideas of reproduction and humans and, you know, men and women and things like that. But they did not have these notions of biological sex in the same way that we do, right? Because now we have this technology, right? We have the ability to look at human genes. We can see X chromosomes and Y chromosomes. So over time, we had theories and we had beliefs and we had ideas and we had, you know, narratives and all of these notions that were circulated. They were very cultural and societal, right? And then we come into this, you know, the Enlightenment and the era of, you know, the scientific method, and now we can prove it. You know, we can prove that this thing called gender difference exists, and we can know how and why it exists. And so this idea of biological sex as being tied to our sex chromosomes, the X and the Y, you know, is a relatively recent idea in society and culture. And so, you know, it's really important that we don't like do this anachronistic thing, right? And try to take the terms of today and put them onto the past, right? We can't fit them in the past into our current understandings and categories. And this is one of the reasons I like to talk about this is to like bring this, you know, into like, where are we now? And so biological sex, I don't know if any of you have read Anne Fausto Sterling's The Five Sexes. I see Kathy and Bobby have just asked about the intersex community. Absolutely, there are many intersex conditions, and there are not just two biological sexes. But when you go to, you know, biology class in high school and you get those, you know, lovely little, you know, I don't know if you remember if you did these in school, you know, four boxes and you've got the X and the Y and like there's only those options. That is not the way that it works. Our genetics are so much more complicated than that. And biological sex is only one facet of the multifaceted concept of gender. And yet it has been used as a determinant. In other words, people will say that if you have an X and an X or an X and a Y, that determines your status, that determines your social roles, that determines your behaviors, that determines the kinds of sexual pleasure you can experience or not. And I don't hold to that essentializing deterministic view of gender. And yet our bodies are biological. And we do have these features of who we are, you know, like our genes, as well as our body parts, that interact with our understanding of our own gendered self. So we figured out this way, as Spencer just commented, gender determinism, boo, I am with you on that. Gender essentialism, boo, I am with you on that. So we go from this, like we can know this biological sex. Well, now, you know, we're all about populations and trying to manage populations. In the wartime, there was like even more going on with trying to categorize people and classify people, keep records on people. And so we started assigning gender at birth. Now that doesn't happen everywhere. There are many people who have birth certificates that do not have a gender on it. And it depends upon the culture, depends upon when and where. And even in the United States, there are some states that, you know, didn't start putting gender assigned at birth on birth certificates until later. So, you know, we've got this now, we come into this world, or we, you know, have to fill out all these documents, and we have this gender assigned at birth thing that was like assigned to us. And now we get into gender identity and gender expression. And these are definitely more recent concepts, right? So we started from, you know, historically in culture, we have these creation narratives, you know, we have the scientific revolution, and then we come up with biological sex and gender assigned at birth. And now we're saying, hey, wait. You know, we have these ideas. We think that gender is a social construct. Scholars have been talking about this for, you know, not forever, but for a while. And so now we're thinking gender is way more complex. It is, you know, it includes like your gender identity, your gender expression, right? Like gender identity, how you perceive yourself, gender expression, how you want to express your gender to other people, how people perceive your gender. That's a whole nother way of thinking about gender. The social construct, right? You know, the things in society that like put you in one box or another, as well as, you know, women do this. I used to get so frustrated at all of the sermon examples, especially about women and shopping, because I was never that woman. So I am genderqueer, gender fluid. I lived as a woman and thought of myself as a woman for many, many years. I have always known that I was queer in some way or another. I have always been shunned for my more masculine traits over the years in many church circumstances. And I tried so hard to be that, you know, how my church socially constructed gender. I tried to fit that thing and failed miserably. That's my greatest failure that I'm very happy that I failed at, because it has brought me here today. I recently, it was in almost a year now, I changed my name officially. And I have to tell you that one of the most affirming aspects of my name change is how my mom has taken it up. And I know for many people, that's a painful thing, because you may not be related with your family in a good way, or your parents have not been very accepting. And as a 78-year-old, I was just really thrilled that my mom embraced Wes and has used it. I kind of had an intermediary phase, and some of you might have met me when I was going by MXWE, M-X-W-E. My initials are W-E, they still are, and they always have been. And she was like, W-E, it's whatever. And I did a hashtag whatever thing for a little while. But when she accepted me as Wes, that was just really a lovely thing. So that's a little aside there on the whole social construct of me trying to be this perfect woman and failing. And here I am. I am not that person, but I am here, and I am excited to be here and still here and still queer. And then we have, you know, in addition to a social construct, we have it as a biopolitical category. And a biopolitical category is where that power comes in, that some of you have talked about in your thinking about and writing about your understanding of what is gender. And I think this idea of a biopolitical category is where we see a lot of the work that is being done today in resisting the binary gender categories that are used for political purposes. And I, you know, it's a lot of interest in thinking about artificial intelligence and how our genders might be read or not read by artificially intelligent systems, or intelligent systems rather. And this is where I do some of my research, is really thinking about the technological implications of these categorizing schemes. And what does that mean? How do we move towards a more fluid and open option? And why do we even, you know, feature this category? And I get frustrated time and time again, and this was part of a discussion we were having earlier, when research is being done and gender is included as a variable, but it's only a binary variable. And the people who are doing the research don't think it's a big deal, but it's like, why do you even want that as a variable? Like, why don't you split people up into two groups by like who's short and who's tall? But these things, they have real world consequences, and they there's definitely power involved in these biopolitical categories. So I am looking at our time and making sure that I'm moving along. There's a lot on this one slide, right? I'm just talking. It's what I do. I like to talk. So our last one is an erotic self, an erotic other. And this is an idea that I really appreciate in thinking about especially like trans and gender expansive people and their experiences of themselves. And so often our understanding of gender is thought of in relationship, or rather our understanding of sexuality is thought of in relationship to others. So when we're categorizing, you know, whether someone is heterosexual or homosexual, right, we're imagining that they have an attraction to an other. And so, you know, this is where I might have us, you know, if we were in a room together, break up into groups and talk a little bit about, you know, in what ways we think that homosexuality disturbs our notions of gender. And this is one of the ways of thinking about gender, our erotic self, that I think is yet another category that we can, or, you know, yet another thing we can put on the list of our understanding of gender, is not just who am I attracted to, but who do I see myself as an erotic self. And so when I imagine, you know, wanting to have erotic experiences with another person, I first see myself as a sexual person, an erotic person who has passions and wants and desires and feelings and needs. And so this idea of, you know, homosexuality is disturbing the norms, right, is very much located in the sense of, you know, the erotic self and the erotic other. In my research on dating apps, I had, a lovely gay young man who was in, you know, conversation coming out to his mom, and his mom, you know, was like questioning his homosexuality and how do you know or whatever. And he was like, you know, this is why I'm homosexual, because I'm a man who loves men. And, you know, and so he very firmly saw himself, his erotic self, as a man. And, you know, and I thought this was, you know, just really well said in his description to me of his conversation with his mom. And I can imagine other people having these kinds of conversations. And his mom just, you know, was very much like, if you are a man, then you must love women. And so if you love men, does that mean you are not a man? And this, I think, is a huge, it's a very big problem that I find in youth group conversations about sex and attraction and purity and all of those things. But that's a whole nother conversation. So let's move on. I would like to hear your thoughts. So you can type them in. We're not going to go into breakouts, but take a few minutes to think about it. Just pull in, you know, your ideas of gender and identities, what you've maybe experienced here at the conference, maybe what you've read, and just think about, how do we know what is true about gender and about identities? So if you want to write that in there in the chat, I will put on another song. And we'll give you a few minutes to think about how you know what is true. I don't know if you all are fans of Snow Patrol, but that's one of my go-to albums lately, Wildness, and it's just Life on Earth. Again, so thrilled to be here with you all and appreciate the comment of someone, I'm trying to find it here. Someone said they felt like they were in college again and they loved that. I'm really glad because, I mean, this is just who I am. Finally, I realized that I could do this for a job and that's cool, but I'm very glad. So River, I just want to let you know that my tattoo artist name is River, and a great name. And I love that it connects with your sense of your gender identity as well. But River comments that, you know, we only know a fraction of what is real. And it's so fascinating, I think, especially within many of our experiences with Christianity, that the emphasis on truth is very much rooted in particular interpretations of particular texts at particular times in particular ways, right? And so many of you are relativists in many ways in thinking about that our understanding of what is true is dependent upon cultures. If we think of gender as a social construct, right, then it is, you know, socially and culturally dependent, right? What is true about gender and identities, how we interact with them and experience them in the world. So there is, you know, absolutely some truth to that. And then, you know, others talked about, you know, it's an internal sense, or I'm not going to judge somebody else's understanding of their gender. And all of this is this idea. And yes, this is the college part. So you're back in college now. Epistemology. How do we know what we know? And in our tradition, and especially in those that have kind of leaned more towards mysticism, there is a lot of sense of knowledge as revelation, that it is revealed to us by God. And some of you mentioned that, you know, it's a conversation that, you know, you and God have. However, we live in a pluralist, multicultural, multi-faith world, and these, you know, truths, right, are debated and contested. So, you know, we have fights and arguments, and, you know, and we exist in that space as LGBTQ Christians who, you know, we are here because we want to be in community with one another. And there are places where what we know is true about ourselves is labeled false. And some of you may have experienced harm because of that. And I am absolutely not a gender determinist or a gender essentialist in any way. And how we know what we know is changing. And I think it might've been River that brought this up again later in the conversation, not to pick on River too much, but you know, questions of can anything be true have been raised in your comments, and I love it. John mentioned observing patterns, right? And this is part of what we do. We observe patterns. We try to categorize things, you know, sorting things out. It's what we do. We try to figure these things out. And so, will we know more in the future? Is there something about gender that is fundamentally fixed and knowable? And that's what I'm not sure about. And, you know, and so As River said, someday science must tell us how hormones in utero, our genes, our bodies, sensitivity, all these things, right, impact. Someday we may be able to tell scientifically. One of the research projects that's going on is to try to identify through functional MRI a trans brain. And first of all, why are we asking these questions? Right? What are the purposes of knowing this? And I have to tell you that, you know, there are some people who would want to know. I mean, if I knew that I was genderqueer younger, would that have changed things? If there was a device that I could use that would tell me the truth about some aspect of me, would I have wanted that? You know, I think that these are important questions for us to think about when we think about how do we know? How do we know what we know? And I am going to pay attention to the time here and see how much time we have left. Ah, it looks like we are at the end of our time almost, and I need to get into a little bit more of this material for you. So looking at Jesus and the way that Jesus interacted with gender, you know, we see the story of the woman at the well, and he absolutely disturbed notions of what was expected of men and women in society in his day. And we also see transgressing of boundaries that were cultural boundaries, gender role expectation boundaries. And this is one of the things that I love about seeing how Jesus interacted, right? Jesus transgressed, right? I love it. He's like, those boundaries, like, forget that. We're not going to take a minute to discuss this, but if Jesus has a gender, right, how do we, if Jesus is God and God is all of these things, right, God made humans in their image, right, God multi, you know, non-binary, some people say God is non-binary, which absolutely, but, you know, we have Jesus. Jesus is a human incarnated with a human body that, you know, likely has chromosomes. And there are some people who are trying to argue, like, you know, well, Jesus had to be intersex, or Jesus had to be, you know, something, right? So looking at this ancient icon, so we're going back a little bit, to think about this idea of whether Jesus has a gender. And this is an ancient icon. I love this. And if I were to describe this, you know, he looks a little bit feminine, like, especially according to today's standards. You know, he's got the longer hair and, you know, definitely a little bit more feminine here. And then we've got, hopefully we have the other picture there. Oh, it got in there twice. So before I go on to the next image, I have another ancient icon. This is one of my favorite kind of thoughts about how to understand and represent and to think about our identities. And it's definitely how we represent our material ties to historical events and social structures. And in the New Testament, we see there is no longer Jew or Greek, there's no longer slave or free, there's no longer male and female. And it's interesting there because it's not or, it's and. And if we think about that in terms of all of our identities of the and is interesting there to me. And we are all one in Christ Jesus. So here's the one, not Neo from The Matrix, if any of you watched that recently. This is Jesus. And he is going to create a new heaven and a new earth. And I am just really disappointed that my icon did not show up in this. So there is another icon, and we will have to save that for another day. But there are new things that Jesus is doing. There is another icon that I like to show that shows Jesus is very masculine. And the reality is, it is just a fold over of an ancient icon. And then I wonder what's going to happen with our technology. How are we going to be in the future if we have a cyborg future of some sort that allows us to modify even more so our gender expression, our gender identity, to be perceived differently than we may feel at times, and to change those things up. And then we have so many images and ideas that are described in the Bible that are indescribable, right? We don't have words for them. And so that's why I really love what River said, right? We only can perceive so much, and yet there is so much more. There is so much more out there. And I like to think of gender as a galaxy. And I am a gender explorer as well as gender queer and gender fluid. And so I'm just thrilled and honored to be on this journey of gender exploring with all of you all, and so wish that I could be with you in person. And I apologize for not leaving time for Q&A, but if you want to drop any questions in the chat, I will also go on Whova and look at any questions there, and I will try to message you all with any responses. So please post any last minute questions in the chat or in the Q&A, and I will stay on here for a few more minutes for any questions that y'all might have. Ooh, my favorite book on this topic. That is a really tough one. Right now I'm enjoying Otherwise Christian, Mix Chris Page. They and I are presenting at another conference in February, and the best books to start with on gender. There's so many. I would like to, for those who want book recommendations, if you can send me a message in the Whova community, I will put together some resources to share with you all. And Irene is asking a little bit more. I apologize for not spending as much time on the woman at the well story of Jesus disrupting gender. Jesus, you know, at the time, men were not supposed to talk, women were not supposed to talk to men in that kind of context. And Jews were not supposed to talk to Samaritans. And as a Samaritan woman, she was also, there by herself. And that was, frowned upon socially in the time. And so Jesus, in many ways, by even having a conversation, transgressed many of the boundaries of the expected gendered behaviors for men and women. And Irene, if you want to message me in the Whova community, I will send you some resources on that interpretation. And thank you, Spencer, for putting the Otherwise Christian in there. And anyone else who would like to share something. I really wish I could see all your faces. Ah, Bridget, I love that question. If Jesus was a humbled version of God, why wouldn't Jesus have come as a woman? A greater show of humbling for the culture of the time. And this is a question that I think is worth exploring. I'm trying to remember who has done it, but there's someone who has made some sort of argument for why Jesus had to be a man. But I think part of it is the aspect of power in the culture. And so being like culturally identified as someone with power, whereas in that time, that day and age, the men, had much more power than the women, that by laying down that power, it would be a more significant divesting of power. And other people are offering wonderful interpretations and information. And then I love River. Yes, this is another question you can ask people. Well, what evidence do you have that Jesus was male and heterosexual? So many good ideas. And the evidence that some people, so River, I'm going to respond to this really quickly. The evidence that some people have about, seeing genitals is whether he was circumcised or not. And so that is probably the only, possible evidence in the scripture that people would have. And I should have stopped sharing this so I could just talk with you all. But I've loved being with you here. And for those of you still here, I appreciate you hanging out and want to make sure that you have plenty of time to get to your next session. Thank you for being here. All right, if there aren't any more questions, I'm going to go ahead and sign off. All right. So, my Q Christian operations person, I have forgotten your name already, and I feel terrible about that.